like anyone. I heard the news on my radio. My mother called and said your brother's son is somewhere in the city and we just don't know. So I drove like hell back to Jersey to pick up my dad and strike out to find my brother who we still had not heard from. Then we headed up Highway 109. Well, we got as far as Hoboken and we saw that skyline smoking. Then a call came through on my mobile phone. I said, hey brother, we're coming to take you home. So I put a flag atop my car, and I put spare change in collection jars, and I watched the news with a poison hate, and for justice to this day I wait. So I'll just say thanks. For all who mourn, and to every child that's since been born, learn about your history. Fear is your greatest enemy. Hang on to your liberty. Bite the hand of tyranny. And here's one. You go down to ground zero. That's the ghost of any hero. If you go down to ground zero, that's the ghost of any hero. If you go down to ground zero.
September 10th, I had just come off for vacation, and I was in Pennsylvania Dutch, and I actually got home midnight, so I literally went into my house, went into the shower, got all my uniform stuff out ready because I have a 5:30 shift, so I get up at 4 o'clock in the morning. So I laid it down for about 2 or 3 hours to get up and go right back to work on September 11th.
I was living in the city, and every night before I went to sleep, because I had a really great view of the Twin Towers, so I could lay in my bed, and right between my feet were the Twin Towers. So I would see the twinkling lights and imagine the people working there. The night before, I got in very late. I had had a rehearsal, and you know, we kind of goofed around afterwards, so I probably got in at, went to sleep about 4 a.m., which is unusual, which was really usual for then for me to be up that late.
The night before 9/11, unfortunately, I was at work because I handled the international settlements, and I had to work on a very large trade with Hong Kong, and having to work on their time frame, which were hours difference from us, I was there until 9:30, 10 o'clock. And I since realized I was by myself in the department. However, it was not unusual of me to take on the task of doing going the extra mile. And nothing unusual. I knew there were securities downstairs, so there was no fear. I had my business done. I took a cab home. And it seemed a regular night. It was actually my sister's birthday.
The night before was just like any other night. September 10th was Monday night. It was unremarkable, normal. and not particularly unusual in any way. There was absolutely no sense of anything different that was going to happen.
Preparing to go to work the next day, I actually, in January of 2001, I adopted a little boy. And it was difficult for me to take him to daycare, hop on the train, go to work, worry about getting back on the train, getting him in time. So it was always like a plan in my head how I was going to do this. That's really the most that I think that I could remember the night before.
Interestingly enough, I do recall a little bit about the 10th of September in 2001, and it had a big impact on me because I became, through my work with the Fire Safety Education Program, I became a substitute teacher. I am a college graduate, not an education major, and on September 10, 2001, it was a proud moment for me. I returned to Tottenville High School, where I was a student, as a substitute teacher.
It was a rainy day, and finished up my normal 11-hour work days and got home roughly around 7 o'clock, 7:30, and sat down, had dinner. There were talks of the weather clearing for tomorrow, and so that was nice. You wouldn't have to walk in the rain.
I'm at work, and I think about the night before 9/11 quite a bit. I was working at 24 the night into the day. So I get to the firehouse Monday night at for 6 o'clock tour till the next evening at 6 o'clock. But yeah, I changed my mutual around so that I could I'd see my cardiologist about something, and I had to take my kids to school Monday. It might have been the first day of school. I'm not sure, at the elementary school. We had several runs that night. Nothing big, just going in, going out. Great place. I knew the next day we had building inspection. I had everything pulled out for that. I had all my T's crossed and my I's dotted. And I was wondering when I was going to be getting promoted. I figured I'd be maybe promoted by the end of the year or early next year.
I don't really remember clearly, but from what I could recollect, it was just a regular normal night. Me coming home from work, taking care of the children, my sister being there babysitting. She always babysat for the children since they've been very young. Actually, since they've been newborn, right after maternity leave, I would go back to work. Just a regular routine night, nothing different, nothing. It was just regular. I took care of the children, I put the baby to sleep, and my son, he was a pretty small toddler, and I had a newborn daughter. And just putting them to sleep, it was just like nothing. I didn't feel anything different, you know, nothing out of the norm.
Well, since I did work that day, I probably just had a very uneventful evening of going to bed a little bit early. In preparation for my next day's work, but I don't recall anything out of the norm whatsoever at that particular time.
On September 10th, I was preparing for another work day in New York City, and I had just been reassigned from one division of the company I worked for, which was Frankel & Company Insurance Brokers, to another division.
Yeah, I was working... I worked for a corporate actions firm. They did corporate reorganization. So we were going, we were taking on a big job. And I remember everyone was called, you know, all hands on deck. And we'd actually agreed the night before to come to work an hour earlier. So that's something that definitely, wow. It's definitely something that, that I remember.
The night before 9/11, it was just another night, watching TV, having dinner, going to bed early. We didn't do anything that was of very big interest, just a regular night for us.
Getting ready for my daughter's first day of pre-K. I don't remember specifics, but just getting ready for her first day of pre-K.
Yeah, that's one of those weird things that it always pops up into my head. It was raining cats and dogs. And the thing that always sticks in my mind is that I had left the Trade Center and gone over to where I catch my bus. I'd gotten on the bus, and right when I sat down on the bus, I remembered that I had left a gift that I had bought for my cousin's baby shower in my cubicle. And I was just like, no big deal, I'll bring it home tomorrow. And it's just one, that's just one of those things that always kind of like pops back up in my head, because it's like, I guess it's that sense of like, tomorrow never came type thing, you know? And so, but that's the thing that always sticks in my head about the Monday night before, was that it was raining really hard and that I was supposed to bring home this gift and I didn't. And my last thought about it was, I'll get it tomorrow.
Well, it's the beginning of the school year, so I'm a school teacher. Not really. I don't really remember. I was probably watching Monday Night Football and...
Nothing really, just hanging out at home. Didn't go anywhere. Didn't work. Was doing the next day.
It was the first week of school. I was eighth grade. I was my last year at the school I was at. I was excited. We were the big kids on campus now. We were ready to rule the school. I was excited to go to school. I wanted it to be over. I wanted to move on. But other than that, normal school night, everything was as it's supposed to be.
The night before 9/11, that's life before 9/11, so it's a totally different world. You just didn't realize it. But for me, I was living up north of the city, about 50 miles away, on a beautiful lake. And Monday night was our drill nights at our fire department, so I went to drill. You know, normally we were doing, a mass casualty drill, so it's pretty ironic. And, you know, just doing our thing, helping to train the younger guys, and hanging out with the guys afterwards, you know, friends, hugging each other, and, you know, all right, see you guys tomorrow. And back to the lake, and it was just a beautiful evening, you know, surrounded by friends. The night before was a gorgeous night, you know, just like the next morning was beautiful sunshine day. That night was just a crisp, nice day in the country. And, you know, I didn't have many cares, you know, other than enjoying my life right then, you know, so.
Absolutely. I work for a virtual health system, and I was working a 911 ambulance, response ambulance. Took an extra shift for somebody, 4:30 in the morning to 11:30 in the afternoon, and I was in the middle of that shift when we got the page, and so I will never forget where I was.
It was remarkably beautiful. A clear day, there wasn't a cloud in sight, so the cold front for that September, it wasn't really cold, but it's cold front nonetheless, had cleared the air of all of the pollutants so you could see forever clearly and sharply. I guess the pilots have two ways of telling you what that sky looked like. CAVU is one of them, CAVU, clear air, visibility unlimited. Or severe clear is the other phrase they use. So you could see forever.
It was this beautiful, extremely clear, perfect day. It could not be more perfect. Chris, clear, you felt invigorated. Very happy day, you know, very good day.
And it was a beautiful day. The sun was out. There wasn't a cloud in the sky. It was dry, sunny, crystal clear, perfect late summer day. And my thought was, you know, how much better could it get than this?
As far as the weather, was a gorgeous day, the best day you could have ever seen. It was visibility. I said to myself, why am I going to work and I could go to the beach? It was beautiful. Spend the day with my children.
Like the guy said, low humidity, absolutely drop dead gorgeous day. I remember got my coffee in the morning, and I didn't like to hang out too much in the kitchen because that's the guy's area. I'd like to stop in, just show my face and do some chit-chat and stuff like that. But then I'd take care of my stuff in the office.
It was a beautiful day. It was a very nice day. It was clear skies, or just maybe a puff or two of wind, just enough to comfort you.
And it was just a beautiful, lovely, gorgeous Tuesday morning, absolutely normal, except that I was going in early.
I could remember, you know, how clear a day it was and how beautiful a day it was and how there was nothing you couldn't see from the Staten Island side.
It was such a gorgeous day. We were hiding underneath the trees because it was starting to get a little bit warm. And in the ambulance, you can get warm very quick. And I hate air conditioning. I'd rather have fresh air than air conditioning.
September 11th, 2001 was a beautiful blue sky day. It was unusually beautiful. And I noticed that. In addition, it was primary voting election day, and so the polls were open and some people were going to vote before they would go to work or conduct their daily activities. It was also the first day of school for some school systems, and so as a result, the offices perhaps were a little bit less filled with people at the time of the attack. As the events unfolded, they really came from out of the blue, and that's literally and figuratively speaking, when these planes entered the tower number one, the North Tower, it was right out of the blue sky. No one could ever have anticipated. And in fact, when it occurred, it was incomprehensible what had happened.
Well, my normal get-up time was around 3:30, 3:45 in the morning. Allowed me time to leisurely get prepared in the bathroom, of course, with the shaving and showering and whatnot. Walked down to the train station. Get there normally around 5 o'clock. Gave me plenty of time to start reading the paper. About 25 minutes trip into Newark and transferring to the PATH train. The PATH train is operated by the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey. And of course, my destination would be the World Trade Center, which was another 22-minute trip.
I got up at about 5:15 in the morning, like I always did. I was getting ready for work. I had was preparing my lunch, like I did every day. I had everything all set up, and I pulled this outfit out of the closet, and I said, this is good. I'll wear a shirt under this pantsuit, because it's going to be cold when I come out. Put my sneakers on, kissed my husband goodbye, and said, okay, honey, I'll call you when I get to work, and then you know, I'll call you when I leave from work. Got on the PATH train and came into the World Trade Center like I'd done every other morning.
I'd been up since 2:30 that morning, got dressed and went to work, was watching, I remember, I Love Lucy.
My husband was on the shift that day that he would go and report it in at 6 a.m., and then if somebody called out sick, he would cover their shift.
Getting up, going to work, getting my son ready for daycare, leave him off, get on the train.
I took the number one subway, 7th Avenue line, as usual. There was a stop within the concourse of the World Trade Center.
Just a regular day, I used to take the subway in from Penn Station, come into the World Trade Center. Take the elevator up. I remember seeing one of my neighbors who didn't make it.
I start my day by coming up through the basement areas out of the PATH station, which is inside the World Trade Center itself. I would always check the doors there and work my way through an access control door, do a little scan and review of what's going on downstairs, make sure the security functions are working properly there. Then work my way up the elevator into the lobby. The lobby visitor desks are just starting to come on duty. They started around 6 o'clock in the morning.
I took the express bus into Manhattan like I usually did at the time, and there was a big delay. Everybody was delayed that morning, and apparently I got to work late. Usually I would get there by, what was it, like an 8:30, 8:15, whatever. I got there maybe 20 minutes late. Everybody was, the Brooklyn Battery time was packed, bumper to bumper that morning. So I know afterwards, everybody said they were late, a lot of people.
You know, driving up the parkway, taking my 40-minute ride to the firehouse. And same routine every morning. You come in, how you doing, guys? And you sit down at the table and you have your morning coffee and the TV is on.
On Tuesday morning, the 11th, I had woken up, was making coffee at the time. The dog wanted out, took care of the dog. Got back to the coffee, and I got a phone call from a friend of mine, a battalion chief in New York City named Ray Downey. Ray was the battalion commander for the special operations team for FDNY, and I had been doing work with him earlier in the summer at the Trade Center, using different devices to raise equipment to the upper floors that firefighters needed, rather than them having to carry it up the stairwells. And it was an interesting project because it involved lifts that the firefighters would carry to the upper floors, and we used the elevator shafts.
Normally, I roll into work like around, well, I used to roll into work at around 9:30, and then I would stay till like 8 or 9 o'clock at night. And because it was the first day of classes, everybody needed to be in early to get everything set up. So I was kind of dragging that morning because I'm not used to getting in that early. But, I got on the bus. I would take the bus and get off basically right in front of Century 21 and walk through the plaza. There was the farmer's market that was going on that morning, and I stopped and I bought a loaf of bread from the Amish bakers, and I put it in my backpack, which also had my computer in it.
That day I decided I was going to take the 4-5 down, and I took the 4-5 down to Wall Street, walked down Pine Street to my office at Wall Street Plaza.
Everything was normal. Getting up that morning, I remember I wore a blue crisp blue shirt, blue skirt. I took the bus as usual. I remember passing by my favorite restaurant, saying hello to the lady that was standing outside, the waitress, and took my bus and went to work on a normal Tuesday morning. Nothing unusual.
I didn't want to go to work because it was such a gorgeous day, so I found a reason to play hooky. And literally, living on the lake, the fish were calling me to go fish it, you know. So I went out on a little boat and, you know, cast the rod a couple of times, caught like a couple of nice big mouth bass.
I live on Staten Island. I was working at a high school that was directly across from the World Trade Center. It's the furthest point you could be, right next to the Staten Island Ferry, McKee High School. We're up on the top of a hillside, and I could remember coming down Victory Boulevard, the main hill, going down before you go up again. Went to work. I was one of the deans of the school. So I was working in the cafeteria at the time for, you know, late breakfast, early lunch, whatever it was.
Yeah, it was a typical morning. You know, my father was at work and he called every morning. And apparently, I remember answering the phone. He asked, did I get called to substitute teach? Because he was on his way home. And I was like, nope, all right, have a good day. See you later. Love you. Same thing any morning would be. My brother and I, my mom dropped my brother and I off at school. My mom, she also works for the Board of Education. She's a para, so she went. Our school, where we were, was only 5 minutes away from where she was. So she dropped us off at school, and it was a normal morning until, you know, we switched classes. I was in math class at the time.
My middle girl, Jackie, said, Daddy, you have to take me to school today. It's picture day. I said, well, get your rear end moving. It's 7:30. I got to be at work at 9. I dropped off at school at 8. Beautiful day.
I got to work about 7:30 that day. As I was busying myself on the phone with a gentleman from our London office, we made a connection to Brooke from Cantor Fitzgerald to resolve the very same trade that I was working on the night before.
So I proceeded. I went to the office, and I followed the signs for Tower 2. And just as I'm doing right now, I pulled out my ID. And on the reverse side is the barcode that you put over the scanner. So it scans you in. I get off the elevator. I went to my desk, just like I did. It was around 8 o'clock in the morning. And I put my pocketbook down, like I have here. I put it down.
This particular morning, we were scheduled to make a demonstration of 9 new doors on the observation deck that we had just put security access control systems in place on them. And we were going to demonstrate them to the manager of the OBS deck for his approval to bring them into the system and turn them on for 24-hour duty. So approximately 8 o'clock, the systems administrator and I went up to the observation deck, which is somewhere between the 108th floor and the 110th floor in the roof line, to make sure that those doors were working. And that when we went to make the demonstration at 10 o'clock, we would have no problems at all.
You get there, and as much of a hassle as it was in the morning, just going up that escalator and seeing Welcome to the World Trade Center was just, it was like a gush, you know? It was a good feeling.
As I'm walking into the building, I'm looking up at the building, I'm saying, oh my God, look how giant this building is. I've only been working here 6 months. And I always felt kind of, I don't know, I can't explain it. Even the day I went for the interview, something was just giving me, honest to God, I just got this feeling like, don't work here. I don't know why. It sounds crazy. I just got a feeling of being very eerie. It wasn't right. I can't explain it. Anyway, that feeling came back to me that morning. And I was only in there 6 months. I still got that feeling here and there throughout the 6 months. But this morning was different.
So I, you know, stopped at the farmer's market. I went through the plaza and I went in to the mezzanine area, you know, just like I always did, go downstairs, show my pass, get on the elevator, go upstairs. And my company was on the 17th floor in the South Tower. We used to always complain, I was going to use a different word, but we used to always complain about the fact that we had no view whatsoever. I mean, you know, we could look out there, our windows and see the plaza and that was it. But on that day, it turned out to be a really good thing that we were on a low floor.
I proceeded along with everybody else and towards Tower 2 to the 36th floor. Frankel occupied the entire 36th floor and half of the 35th floor. And on the way up the stairs towards Tower 2, there was this young musician who would play great violin music. And that morning, he was playing Mozart, and I stopped for like a minute just to listen. I'm thinking, okay, Mozart, send down your good vibes.
Perhaps there were, roughly speaking, a third of the staff were present. We had a significant staff, four floors, 79th floor, 81 and 82. I was on the top floor of our four floor on 82nd floor.
I had my cup of coffee from the Roach coach and then I went upstairs, started my day sifting through files upon files to see which files were valid to keep for study.
Went in, it was nothing. Made coffee. You know, stood around, chit-chatted with my colleagues, and then, you know, started just getting into work.
Getting coffee, going upstairs, I wore sneakers to work, and put my shoes on, and went over to talk to a coworker that day. I had a picture of my son that I took at home and wanted to show her, so I was talking to her at that time.
And I went and I sat at my desk, and I logged on to my computer, and the funny thing was I didn't put my pocketbook in my bag, in my drawer, like I usually do. I left it on the floor. And then I'm just logging in.
Probably about 8:15 or 8:30, thereabouts. And as usual, I just turned on my computer, reading email, and as I had done for many years and still do to this day, I was enjoying a cinnamon raisin bagel and a cup of coffee as I watched or I looked at my screen and did email and maybe read some papers in my inbox. It was very quiet, unremarkable.
Normally in the mornings, we have a 9 o'clock group meeting with the management. So I get ready for that. I get in about 8:30. I used to take off my shoes, get my coffee, drink my coffee. And then usually at about 5 or 10 to 9, my friend Brian would come down. He's also one of the senior managers. And then we'd go into the morning meeting, which was in a conference room, two offices from where I was. And I was on the 79th floor.
I had a nice routine in my life. I was waking up every morning at 6 a.m., no alarm clock, feeling good and ready to go. I looked forward to each day and going to work and doing a good job. And I remember taking the the boat, the Staten Island Ferry, into Manhattan. I was on the 8 o'clock boat. The boat tied up in Manhattan at 8:30, and I got on the subway to go uptown, a couple of short stops, and when I exited the subway at Houston Street at 8:45, things took a very big change.
Yeah, dispatcher.
Yes?
This is off-duty firefighter Jermaine. I guess you got this already. But you got a plane crashed into the World Trade Center. You aware of that?
You have a plane that crashed into the World Trade Center in Manhattan?
World Trade Center in Manhattan.
Well, where are you going from?
I'm on Varick Street in Manhattan.
Varick Street in Manhattan.
The North Tower, World Trade Center.
North Tower?
North Tower. You got...
And the phone number you're calling from?
I'm on a cell phone. I'm an off-duty firefighter. My name is Jermaine.
Okay.
It's North Tower, Vichy Street. You got
Vichy Street, God. Okay, thanks a lot.
Send them all because you got a major fire on the upper floors of the World Trade Center.
We heard something on the regular radio that plane went into the Twin Towers. And I just looked at Jen. I said, turn the shit off. I said, this is just not even funny. So the radios are all blaring at this point saying there's an MCI, which is a mass casualty incident at the World Trade Center, and it was a small plane into the tower.
Well, I watched. My pager went off. It was 8:46. That we were paged at exactly when the first tower was struck. Called my supervisor and he said, we already have somebody en route. Go home, get your dog.
I looked up and I saw this huge hole in the side of the building. I didn't expect to see that big of a hole. I was astounded by it. I had worked in the building for 5 years and knew that that many floors meant that that was a tremendous hole. And if that was coming out that way, I could imagine that, you know, even the incoming hole would be tremendous.
We felt this rumble. The building started to shake a little bit. We sort of looked at each other and said, what the hell is that? And about that time, the radios went off. We've just been hit by an airplane, Tower 1. Big fireball, huge explosion. There's flames and smoke all over the place. There's debris falling. There are papers all over the place.
When the first plane hit, it woke me up. So I was actually asleep, but I didn't know that's what it was. And I looked around and I thought that something had happened, but I really hadn't heard anything. And then I looked out past my toes and I saw an amazing amount of smoke and went to the window. And when you're that close, it looked completely different than on television, which I didn't turn on, because you could see the flames. The flames were 3, 4, 5 stories high behind the windows.
At that point, it looked like the sun that was going to come through our window. It was the explosion from the other building. I basically saw that and just ran to the next stairway and just headed on down, shaking like you cannot believe, not knowing what happened. Nobody knew. Nobody was rushing, running. They were walking fast down 92 flights of stairs.
I stepped off the elevator. And it must have been right at 8:46, because when I stepped off the elevator on my floor, and what I heard sounded like they had dropped something heavy upstairs. And I hear, bang, bang, and I felt the building sway. And then I look up, and I see the nose of an airline plane come through the tower across the plaza.
I heard a blast about 7:45 or 8:45, and all of a sudden all my phone and Brooke said, what the hell was that? And I was like, I don't know. And I felt the building went to the left and came back to the right, and my coworker Chris pulled me and said, get down, we've been bombed.
And then I continued to just, you know, head into the office. But before I could even get into the office proper, people started coming out of the office saying that a bomb had gone off somewhere.
But then at about 1:45 or thereabouts, heard something, and you looked out the window and you saw the people just scurrying out. They looked like ants coming out of the ground. And then I saw papers flying around, so it was obvious. We didn't know what happened, but it was obvious something happened. The building rocked. Like in a train, you know, when a train center comes to a stop, and that's what it felt like. And that's when I think everybody changed.
Somehow became aware that something had happened. This was just after 8:46 a.m. when the first plane entered tower number one. I looked out the window, and what I thought I saw was confetti rising, going up. And I thought this strange. What I later realized was this was not confetti. These were 8.5 by 11 sheets of paper, but the enormity of the scale of the buildings made it appear as though these were just small pieces of paper. And I could see that tower number one was on fire, and I could see the enormity and the extent of the damage.
I felt a little jerk at the table, at my desk, and then the guy sitting next to me said, me and both said at the same time, what was that? It was a little jerk. And then all of a sudden we felt a big, and that's when Peter, one of the guys we worked with, said, under the desk. That's all I heard. And I jumped under my desk.
And I just sat there and I thought, hey, wait a minute. I didn't sign up for this. What the hell is going on? So we all got up and we all went like this. How'd they do that? Dear God, how stupid are you? You can't see a 100-story building? What's the matter with you, you idiot? And we just stood there like fascinated. We didn't know what to do.
I just remember looking up, and a gentleman by the name of John Yehovas comes running out of his office. His booming voice said, Caroline, turn up the volume. The World Trade Center has just been hit or something.
A few minutes later, I was pulled from under the desk, and the securities came up, and they said that it was a minor accident. There was a plane hit the roof of the building. However, don't panic. At the time, nobody knew whether it was a bomb or it was just the minor accident on top of the roof. By then, you started smelling this burning and rubber, and just I do now smell this hairy smell of burning of hair and everything. And people started panicking. Then all the sprinklers went off, and you were wet. Some of us, I personally don't know if I had peed on myself or it's from the water that was now coming down on us.
And we're just running down the stairs, and I'm going, oh my God, what's going on? And I'm smelling smoke. I'm smelling like fire. All of a sudden, I'm telling you, even before I ran down the stairs, there was smoke immediately in all over. Anyway, I'm running down the stairs. I'm going, oh my God, what is this? Maybe it's an earthquake. What is it? You know, I just didn't understand it. And I'm saying to myself, oh God, you know, I want to get out of this. I'm pleading with God, give me 20 more years. I don't care. Whatever you want me to do, I'll do. I'm going down, and I see a firefighter coming up, and I said to my, you know, they're going up with the hoses on their shoulders, and a firefighter is coming up. A fire captain with a suit on is coming up with an axe. I'm saying, my God, why is he coming up? Usually they're down at the bottom, but I said to myself, my God, it must be very bad up there. They look petrified. When I tell you petrified, knowing that they were petrified, I'm saying to myself, what am I supposed to think? So I said to one of the firemen, I said, what's going on? He goes, you don't want to know? Just get out of the building.
I had been there in 93, and I didn't go out right away, and I regretted it. That was a real bad experience in 93. So I decided to leave, and I started down the stairs, very calm. We got to the 44th floor, which in the World Trade Center was one of the sky lobbies. And the personnel there, security, or the building personnel, were telling people to get out the stairs and go on the skylight and go back to your offices. They told us a plane hit World Trade Center 1 and that we were safer in the building, that there was debris falling down. So we all started getting on the 44th floor, but there was a mass of people in the sky lobby. And then just something inside of me just said, I want to get to the ground floor. Again, I think remembering how I felt in 1993. So I just started going against the traffic. Everybody was, and I just kept on going downstairs.
We just had a plane crash into the upper floor of the World Trade Center, transmit a second alarm, and start relocating companies into the area. The World Trade Center, tower number one, is on fire. The whole outside of the building was just a huge explosion.
They had determined that a plane had struck tower number one and that emergency help was on the way. But at that time, we had no sense of why a plane had entered tower number one, or was it a small helicopter or some other type of accident, similar to what had happened at the Empire State Building when a plane actually entered purely accidentally. One of the upper floors.
And over the loudspeaker, because one of the teachers, her daughter was working in Lower Manhattan, so over the speaker they said, there's been an accident in Manhattan, there's nothing to worry about, we're just letting the teachers know everything's okay. And thought nothing of it. Then, slowly but surely, kids were being called out of school, little by little by little, and it just got a little bit more bizarre, and we were just a little bit more concerned.
As I came in, I heard them talking about, you know, something was happening at the World Trade Center. Like there was it looks like a small plane and this and that. And I'm looking at the building on the news, and I was like, I know that city. I grew up in Queens. It just didn't look like it was a small plane. And then I'm thinking, well, did they have a heart attack? I mean, it must have been a bigger plane, and he must have accidentally veered in. And they're explaining this thing.
As I'm coming up to the top of the Verrazano, I saw the smoke. I said, well, maybe it's a pier fire, because you would get your pier fires in Brooklyn or Manhattan. And it's all black smoke. And when I got to the top, I saw the North Tower was burning. Put on the news, and they said it was a small plane crashed into it.
You know, people on the street are saying a plane hit Tower 1. And that was when I first looked up and saw that there's all the smoke pouring out of Tower 1.
Initially, we didn't know what was going on. We really didn't. We had no idea.
When I exited the subway, for the first time, I could see with my eyes what had happened. I looked up and I could see the towers on fire, aflame. Horrific, terrible. I knew that people must have been killed, and I knew this was an event of great significance, so much so that my first thought was to watch, because this is history happening, and I would witness history, I would watch it. But perhaps my instincts and my need to survive got the better part of my judgment, which I, in retrospect, was the right thing, and I thought, no, I think I will just get as far away from here as I can.
I know my first take on it was, well, no major airliner or anything is going to crash into the World Trade Center. It was probably some errant smaller plane or some private pilot or whatever. But in looking at it, the damage was a bit significant. Don't forget, we're getting the first pictures coming in, so the smoke wasn't really at its full billowing at the time. And so it could have possibly been a smaller plane. And that's the take we're all trying to have on it. The thought of terrorism or anything like that, not even in our minds. It was an accident. So as we continue to watch, it does start looking really bad.
I remember hearing on the news, something went into the World Trade Center. It's some pictures from a traffic helicopter of, you know, like the side of the building, the side of the North Tower. And at the time, you could see a little flame, and they said, no, they think maybe a small plane went into it. And the first thing I thought was, I bet that ultralight guy from a week before lost control and went into the side of the building. And I was thinking, no big deal, you know, it's just a little bit on the outside. And the angles they showed of the North Tower, from the TV clips that I saw quickly, didn't look like much. And they came across second alarm on the voice alarm, second alarm in Manhattan, box 8087. And the running joke in some of the busier areas is when you have a high-rise fire in Manhattan, it's kind of like, you know, a garbage pail fire or something like that, because the buildings are so complicated that even a small smoke condition is a major thing in an occupied building of 10 or 20,000 people. Then you hit third alarm, you know, fourth alarm, and then the pictures were coming in on the news because it was on every station. And you could see, like, oh, this thing's really cooking. And it's tough to get perspective on a building that large. Truck got the alarm. I think they went on the north. They were assigned early, third, maybe a third alarm on the north tower. That was the first building was hit. They took off because it's a double house, the engine and truck.
Engine 1-0 to Manhattan.
Engine 1-0.
World Trade Center 1060. Send every available ambulance, everything you got to World Trade Center now.
At that point, we took off and we headed down to the main highway. And as we got onto the highway, two other fire department units were going past us. I think that's the first time that we saw the one tower burning. The second plane had not hit at that point.
When I emerged from the subway at Houston Street in Varick, which is 1 mile north of the Trade Center, I heard a woman say, "Look at the fire." So, being in the business, I instinctively looked up. I did not see the impact of the plane, but I witnessed the result of it probably moments after impact. I had a perfect view from 1 mile north of, looking directly down at the north tower, which the plane impacted, the north face of the north tower and the upper floors. So I witnessed a fireball hundreds of feet in the air. I witnessed the structure of the building punctured, probably 15 floors high from up to down, and a huge fire coming out of it. I knew exactly what it was. Even though I didn't see the plane, you would think, oh, it was an accident, it was a small plane. I knew exactly what it was. I had been there for the previous attack in 1993. I was on duty and responded that day. And my greatest fear was, what if they ever took these towers down? I went into emergency mode immediately upon seeing what happened. And instinctively, I called the dispatcher directly, and I was giving him a report of what I saw. And evidently, since I called direct, that was one of the first calls the department received. The dispatcher wasn't even aware of what I was talking about, so I repeated myself. And as I was giving that call, I could hear in the background the noise of the police horses. The horses from the mounted unit, which were located nearby, were responding. I could hear the clip-clop of the horses. I could hear ambulances. And I heard from around the corner, from my location, engine 24, ladder 5, I could hear them turning out onto quarters, out of quarters to respond. So I knew what we were up against right from the get-go.
Send them all because you got a major fire on the upper floors of the World Trade Center.
We had a large fire to fight, and we had a great possibility of losing a lot of people, especially at that time in the morning. I had worked there. And I remember seeing thousands and thousands of people coming in that Trade Center from the path train alone. Panic must have struck in. Certainly the people upstairs were dead.
I got onto the elevator, and this is building 2, of course. And when I got downstairs, there wasn't anybody in the lobby. And when I walked through the revolving doors to walk through the concourse area to run over to building 1, there wasn't anybody in sight. Now this is 9:15 in the morning. And normally we have thousands of people roaming around, coming and going, either transiting through the area or getting from where they stopped off to pick up their breakfast and to get to the elevators to go into their building or whatnot. As I make my way down, I see that the lights are out as I get closer to building 1. And when I got very close to it, the huge hanging signs that would tell you where to go, here for path, there for tower 2, somewhere to go to World Financial, etc. These are very large stainless steel signs, and they're all bent and twisted. And as I get around the corner, There are no lights now except the security lights and the sunshine that's coming in through the windows. All the sprinkler heads are spewing water. And I stop and I look. Now I know what happened. You know, what had happened was that fireball that had come down through the elevator shafts had bounced around the lobby, swung around the lobby, and came right through the revolving doors. And that heat melted the fuses, and so now the water is spilling all over the place. So I took a couple of showers getting into the revolving doors, got in and started with the evacuation plan, which was to send everybody out towards West Street, because that's where we would normally have the first responders coming, the fire department, the ambulance corps from the various hospitals, or from the EMTs that would come in, police. And so I'm sending them out that way, because if they're going to need treatment, they're going to be triaged as soon as they hit that area. But shortly after doing that, a fireman comes up to me and tells me, "Sir, it's not a good idea to send them out that way. It would be better if you sent them through the concourse up to Church Street." Now, the reason it was going to be better, and he told me it was dangerous out there or unsafe, was that some of the people that were trapped above the impact point, you know, the plane hit around the 93rd floor, and two or three floors above it were heavily damaged. But in doing so, the plane took out all of their escape routes, the stairways, the elevators. They were all taken out by the impact of that aircraft. And they had only one more option, because if they weren't burned to death, killed on impact, or suffocating from the smoke, they had one more option. You make your peace with God, and you take that other option, or you stay with one of the other options. And that last option was to jump.
There was a guard, security personnel from the building, that was advising people to return to their workstation. Do not go down to the plaza area. Do not exit the building. It was a terrible, tragic misjudgment. But the reason was ostensibly to protect those from debris that was falling down because of the plane that had struck tower number one. There was a moment of inner thought. I doubted that would be the right thing to do, to return to my office. After all, I'm a New Yorker. I'm a survivor. I have an instinct that says if something has happened nearby, like a fire or any sort of potential problem, get as far away from it as you can. What would I be doing? Going back to my office and sitting down and writing emails? I mean, it was inconceivable anyway that I would just go back and continue my work. But that all happened in just a few seconds. I was thinking, I don't think so. And then I felt the second plane enter the tower I was in, and I felt the building shake. I felt it move, and I knew instantly this was not an accident. This was an attack. This was a terrorist attack. And I thought the building may collapse at that moment, and I thought this might be the end of my life.
It still wasn't, the pulse wasn't beating too hard yet at that point. And then one of the guys, I guess the house watchman, came running in, and he goes, "The South Tower was just hit. I saw the plane fly right up the East River, or the Hudson River part is there." And he goes, "We're under attack. It's a terrorist attack." And I have to tell you, I felt like I got hit in the head with a hammer. I was like, why didn't I see this? What was I thinking? And I was like, wow, really? And then we really started focusing on the news. But then we got the response ticket to go. We were assigned on the fifth alarm for the South Tower.
Definitely something hit the second tower. Approximately two-thirds of the way up, you got visible fire showing out there. Suggest to the incoming commander to transmit a fifth alarm for
Manhattan with an urgent.
Stand by.
Unless
urgent. Manhattan calling, call Fort David K. Manhattan calling, call Fort David.